Kickstarters. Kickstarters everywhere. How's it going, guys? Angus here from Maker's Muse. Yes, shock horror, I got a haircut. It's a little bit short for my liking, but knowing my hair, it will grow back. But today's video is all about Kickstarter projects in the wonderful world of 3D printing. Right now on Kickstarter, there is 8 projects. Everyone wants me to talk about them, so I figured I'd just do one video covering every single one. Let's go for it. So let's start with the tungsten 3D printing nozzle by DDD Material that is fully funded and still has like a month to go. So the idea behind this is tungsten is a lot harder than your regular brass nozzles. So when you're printing abrasive filaments like carbon fiber loaded or metal filled PLAs, they will eat into your brass nozzles and destroy them. But a lot of people are using stainless steel nozzles and these work better, but they're still not that much harder and in fact have a much worse heat conductivity. So that means that when you're heating them up on your printer, they don't maintain the temperature as well. So the idea behind the tungsten nozzle is just to have a nozzle that just never breaks and can actually heat up quite nicely. The downside is they're really expensive, so that's why they've gone to Kickstarter to fund a batch of them. In my opinion, they're still too expensive for me to justify personally. You know, I could go through like 20 or 30 brass nozzles before having to justify one of these nozzles, but if you're serious and you have a bit of money to burn, it might be a worthwhile investment. Also, it might be a really nice Christmas present for someone with a 3D printer. Just make sure you buy them the right type for their printer. That could end in tears. And next we have Lockbuild by Steelsman 3D. So Steelsman has been on Kickstarter before to fund their Modify 3D sculpting tool for 3D printing projects, and I reviewed that quite some time ago. So Lockbuild is their 3D printing surface they're bringing out, and they're kickstarting. It's already well beyond their goal, so it's only just launched. I've actually been testing out this surface for quite some time for the guys over at Steelsman 3D, and in my experience it works exactly the same as BuildTac, pretty much the same experience. So when you're printing in PLA it works really well, but I did find I had to warm the plate back up to cleanly release the parts. So I've been using another print surface called PrintBite recently, and that will self-release, also like glass will self-release as well with PLA, but with this surface, like BuildTac, you have to sort of warm it back up to get it off. But it does work very well, and that's currently on Kickstarter as well. And next is Cetus 3D. I just reviewed the Cetus 3D printer and they're now live on Kickstarter, but I do need to update you on some points. So when I reviewed the printer, basically I said I can't reveal who's behind it. Well, now I can. Teartime is behind the Cetus 3D and they're well known for producing the Up 3D printers. So I said there was a lot of manufacturing behind it. Yeah, they know what they're doing when it comes to manufacturing 3D printers. So that might make some of you feel a little bit safer in terms of backing this project. But one thing that has annoyed me a little bit is the product that I was sent has high wind linear rails, genuine high wind linear rails, which are very nice. But they're sort of shying away to committing to what sort of rails they're going to use in the final product, saying they might use some from Japan, saying they might use something else. They're saying they're not going to use high wind in the final product, which sort of means I was a bit misled in my review, and I want you guys to be completely comfortable in terms of what you're backing. So I do ask Cetus to clarify exactly what they're going to use. So IKO rails are what they're saying they're going to use now, which I said are from Japan. They're still very good, but I can't quantify how good they are compared to my experience with the higher end rails. Also, the shipping has increased, so a lot of you guys are a bit upset about that, but to be fair, they are shipping from China all around the world, and you ship basically on volume, not by weight, and the printer's light, but it does take up a lot of space. So, like $50 to the US, I mean, sending a box that size anywhere in Australia would probably cost me $50 US. So, it's expensive, but yeah, I don't think there's any way around it. They probably realized that last minute that it would cost them a lot of money to ship. And now on the other end of the spectrum in terms of 3D printers is the RepWrap BigBot by Jared. So this is a relatively new campaign by the looks of it. He's got $7,000 raised. He needs to raise a lot more money, but it is a 3D printing kit that can print at the largest size up to 600 by 600 by 300 millimeters in size, which is huge, and the price to do that is actually fairly reasonable. So this is sort of, in my opinion, how Kickstarter should be used. It is a Kickstarter to raise funds to buy all the parts in bulk and then you assemble it as a kit. So the best of luck to him. 50 grand is a lot to raise for such a niche printer, in my opinion, but we'll see how it goes. And the link for that is also in the description. And moving along the list is the CX5 sculptable filament currently on Kickstarter. So this is, I remember seeing the video for it ages ago, but this is a really neat filament where you can print prototypes and then smooth and sculpt them like you would with clay or like polymer clay. It's really nice looking, it's just really expensive. I can't personally justify the cost for it, which is a shame, but they do have to justify a whole new material they've developed, and that's currently got a few hours left, so if you watch this video in time and you really want to back it, definitely back it, but they have crossed their minimum, so they will get funded, and I am keen to see how these guys go, but as I said, it's still too expensive for me to justify. I bought a 3D printer because I can't hand model anyway, so it's not really a product that I'd personally be able to make use of. And of course we have the M3D Pro, which I did review their Kickstarter campaign a little while ago. I got mixed results on that. A lot of people are very critical of the original M3D Micro. I do need to stress this is a new product, but it is the same company. And a lot of people thought I was pretty salty about not getting a unit. I'm really not. I am bombarded with printer review requests on a daily basis, but I am a little bit critical as to some of their design choices, especially the small motors. 3D printers, they do have a lot of mass. And that's one area where the M3D Micro really did fall down. But regardless, they've got tons of money, they're 100% funded, and if you're interested, you can also find the link for that one and all these other campaigns in the video description. And next we have the Bunker by 3D Printing System. So I've known Bruce for quite some time, and I did interview him on the channel some time ago, and I have been sort of talking to him for a long time while he's been developing this product. I do honestly think it's a really, really neat idea. Not really if you're a home user with one 3D printer, but if you're running a university or hackerspace or class environment where you've got many machines to manage. Like for example, I used to print on demand as my day job, and to have filament run out because you're on the phone or because you just didn't look when you sent a new job is so, so frustrating. So the product in that regard would pay for itself, and I really think that they do need a little bit of help to get to their funding amount, but I really do wish them the best of luck. And to round off this list, we have the Prometheus System by Eric, which is also fully funded on Kickstarter with like a month to go. So Eric was kind enough to send me some sample prints as well of the of his Prometheus system, and the system is basically a dual extruder design with one nozzle. So dual extrusion is that sort of next best thing for 3D printing. I think that it's going to become much more popular once systems like this become better established and more user friendly. So that's what he's trying to push. And the idea behind it is it's just got one nozzle and two feeds. So there's a few advantages and disadvantages of this. I'm not going to go too much into detail because I'm not hugely familiar with the technology he's using. Burbs. But basically, when you have a single nozzle extruder, for dual materials, you avoid a lot of that cross-contamination and oozing where, you know, one nozzle stops and just oozes out and it contaminates the print. But you do run into some other issues. For example, temperature variations. You may have two materials that need different temperatures. Do you heat your extruder up to the higher one, so the lower end one maybe is extruding too hot? Or do you try to find a middle ground where one will extrude a bit more viscous than the other? Things like that. And also you do need to purge that nozzle between each change. So you can see in Eric's time lapses, he has like a column building up beside the print where he will sort of do a purge where it will go between the materials. So the prints on this system will definitely take a lot longer than a regular dual nozzle, dual color print. But in terms of the print quality, they are really nice and clean. They're pretty darn good, I will say. Joel and Tom both got sent these samples. I do kind of have New Zealand on mine. The prints are very clean. The color transition is very crisp. I can't really see any transition, cross-contamination, but I can see a little bit of stringing. That's just his printer. But yeah, it's an impressive looking system, and if you're interested in upgrading your machine to have dual extruder capability, but it's only got room for one nozzle, it might be for you. Something I did notice is it seems to add a lot of bulk to your printer. It's got the sort of Y feeder, and then it's got the much longer integrated nozzle and heat tube, and then it's got the extra two motors externally. So it will add a lot of bulk to your system. I'm not sure if some machines will be able to handle that, so it's definitely something to look into. But yeah, it's pretty cool. So I think that's gonna round up this video, guys, of the 8 3D printing Kickstarter projects currently live right now. I just needed to get them out in one video because there's just too many of them. And if you want to see or find out any more information on them, you can find the links in the description. I have done a review on the Cetus, which is completely unbiased. They just sent me one to get a review and get information out, which they are currently using for their campaign. probably should have charged them for that. And if you want to see any future 3D printing videos on Maker's Muse, guys, don't forget to subscribe. It helps me out a huge amount. I love doing this sort of content for you guys, and I'd love to have you on board. Look forward to seeing you again very shortly here on Maker's Muse. Catch you later, guys. Bye.
In the latter half of the 20th century, a man has sent rockets into deep space. He has placed satellites into orbit. He has actually walked in space.
So many Kickstarters.